Hello, I am Dr. Kuldeep and I welcome you all in my YouTube channel. Today we are going to discuss about water and mineral metabolism. We possess tremendous capacity to survive against ups and downs and maintain our homeostasis. This is particularly true with regard to water, electrolyte and acid-base status of the body. These water, electrolyte and acid bases are interrelated and hence they are considered together in this discussion. Before going toward the discussion, let's see what are the learning outcomes of this video lecture. After going through this video lecture, you will be able to explain the distribution of water in the body, describe the importance of water balance and organs involved in maintaining the water balance. Define dehydration and give its symptoms, causes and treatment. Define electrolyte balance and acid-base balance. How body maintains the normal pH. The pH is very much essential to carry out various metabolic processes. And last one, state the various disease mechanism of changes in blood pH. Let's see what are the functions of kidney that participates in the regulation of water, electrolyte and acid-base balance. All we know that kidney forms the urine by three processes: filtration, secretion and reabsorption. By these three processes, kidney excretes metabolic waste. These wastes are nothing but the end products of protein and nucleic acid, as well as it reabsorbs the several substances of biochemical importance. By these processes, it is able to maintain the homeostasis and regulate water, electrolyte and acid-base balance. Apart from these, kidney also performs some hormonal functions. It secretes erythropoietin that stimulates hemoglobin synthesis and erythrocytes formation. The calcitriol, which is the active form of vitamin D, is produced from the kidney. The renin, which is a proteolytic enzyme synthesized in the kidney, stimulates the formation of angiotensin II. Angiotensin II will further stimulate the aldosterone production that helps in regulation of electrolyte balance. Let's see about the first part, that is water balance. Water is recognized as solvent of life. Water is more important than any other single compound to life because it is involved in several body functions. Here some water functions are described. Some biochemical reactions inside the body requires aqueous medium and which is given by water. Water directly participates as a reactant in the several metabolic reactions. In the body, some solutes are transported from one organ to other organ and they require vehicle which is fulfilled by water. And water is closely associated with the regulation of body temperature. Let's see the distribution of water. Water is a major component of body. An adult human contains about 60% of water. If an adult weighing 70 kg, then approximately he will have 42 liters of water. This 42 liters of water is distributed in two compartments. One is intracellular fluid, which contributes near about 66%, and extracellular fluid, which contributes about 33%. In extracellular fluid, the 25% is present in intravascular and 75% in interstitial fluid compartment. This 60% of water is regulated by body itself. In a healthy individual, this is achieved by balancing the daily water intake and water output. We have two sources of water. One is exogenous and other one is endogenous. The exogenous source of water, that means the water and beverages and the solid foods that we consume contains a water and that we directly intake into the body. This exogenous water intake is controlled by climate and the thirst center located in hypothalamus. Increase in the osmolality of a plasma causes increased water intake by stimulating thirst center. Whereas the endogenous water is the metabolic water which is produced within the body in various endogenous reactions. The metabolic water which is produced within the body by the oxidation of the foods like carbohydrate, proteins and fats. About 125 milliliter of water is generated for every 1000 calorie that we consume. Let's see what are the sources of water output. Water output is also called as water loss. There are four distinct routes for the elimination of water from the body: urine, skin, lungs and feces. Urine is the major route of water loss from the body. In a healthy individual, the urine output is about 1 to 2 liter per day. It is essential as a medium to eliminate the waste products that are water soluble. Various hormones regulate urine production, which is controlled by vasopressin, which is also known as antidiuretic hormone of the posterior pituitary gland. The secretion of antidiuretic hormone is regulated by the osmotic pressure of a plasma. An increase in osmolality promotes ADS secretion that leads to an increased water reabsorption from the renal tubules. Other source is skin. Loss of water occurs through the body surface by respiration, also called sweating. This is an unregulated process by the body which mostly depends on the atmospheric temperature and humidity. The loss is more in hot climate. If a person is suffered with fever, causes increased water loss through the skin. It is estimated that for every 1 degree centigrade rise in body temperature, there is about 15% increase in observed in the loss of water through skin. Other is lungs. During respiration, some amount of water is lost through the expired air. The latter is saturated with water and expelled from the body. In hot climates and or when the person is suffering from fever, the water loss through lungs is increased. Another route is the feces. Most of the water that we consume is reabsorbed by the intestine. About 150 ml per day is lost through feces in a healthy individual. Fecal loss of water is tremendously increased when a person suffered with diarrhea. To summarize water intake and water output, let's see the another slide. Before that, point to be noted that diabetes insipidus is a disorder characterized by the deficiency of antidiuretic hormone, which results in an increased loss of water from the body. We know that 70 kg of a person contains 60% of water, that comes near about 42 liters. So body always maintains the turnover and the balance of the water by water intake and manage it by water output. Various sources of water intake are drinking water, foodstuffs and metabolic water. Whereas water output through various routes like urine, skin, lungs and feces. If The total consumption of water intake is 2.5 liter per day. The same amount of water is excreted through different route and the amount is same, that is 2.5 liter. According to the environmental condition, the excretion from the various routes is varies. My dear listeners, please answer to this question in the comment box. What happens if water output is decreased than the water intake? Let's move toward the electrolyte balance. The compounds which readily dissociate in a solution and exist as ions, that is positively and negatively charged particles, are called electrolytes. These electrolytes are well distributed in the body. Various body fluids contains the amounts of electrolytes. Here, the composition of various electrolytes in extracellular fluid and intracellular fluid is depicted. From this table, we can conclude that sodium is a major or the principal extracellular cation, whereas the potassium is a principal intracellular cation. We can express the concentration of molecules with regard to osmotic pressure in osmolarity and osmolality. Osmolarity is the number of moles per liter of solution, whereas osmolality is the number of moles per kilogram of a solvent. If the water is solvent, there is almost no difference between osmolarity and osmolality. However, for biological fluids that contains the proteins, the osmolality is more commonly used. Osmolality of a plasma is a measure of the solid particles present in the plasma, which is in the range of 285 to 295 millimoles per kilogram. Sodium and its associated anions make the largest contribution to plasma osmolality. For practical purposes, plasma osmolality can be computed from the concentrations of sodium, potassium, urea, and glucose. The depiction is written here. The factor 2 is used for sodium and potassium to account for the associated anionic concentration. Plasma sodium is most abundant contributor of osmolality. The above calculation is get simplified to plasma osmolality is equal to 2 into plasma sodium concentration. This formula is only true when the glucose and urea are in the normal range or they are present in the plasma at a normal concentration. It is not be valid in severe hyperproteinemia and lipemia. Water and electrolyte balance simultaneously regulated by kidney. The regulation is mostly achieved through the hormones aldosterone, antidiuretic hormone, and renin angiotensin. Aldosterone is a mineralocorticoid produced by adrenal cortex. Aldosterone increases sodium reabsorption by the renal tubules and excretes potassium and hydrogen ions. The net effect is the retention of sodium in the body. Whereas antidiuretic hormone is releases from hypothalamus when there is increase in plasma osmolality, and which is mainly attributed to increase in sodium ion concentration. So, antidiuretic hormone effectively increases water reabsorption by renal tubules. Renin angiotensin is another system that regulates electrolyte and water balance.
The secretion of aldosterone is controlled by renin angiotensin system. Decrease in the blood pressure, that is due to decrease in extracellular fluid volume, is sensed by juxtaglomerular apparatus of the nephron, which secrete renin. Then renin acts on the angiotensinogen to produce angiotensin 1. The latter is then converted to angiotensin 2, and these angiotensin 2 stimulate the release of aldosterone from adrenal cortex. As well as this angiotensin 2 acts on angiotensin 2 receptors and causes fall in blood pressure. Atrial natriuretic peptide is secreted by right atrium, and that increases sodium excretion from the kidney. In this way, these are the factors that regulate water and electrolyte balance simultaneously. Dehydration, a negative water balance, is a condition characterized by water depletion in the body. It may be due to insufficient intake or excessive water loss or both. Dehydration is generally classified into two types: due to loss of water alone or due to deprivation of water and electrolytes. Let's see what are the causes of dehydration. Dehydration may occur as a result of diarrhea, vomiting, excessive burns, fever, excessive sweating, increased urination, kidney disease, and excessive exercise. Moreover, adrenocortical dysfunction, deficiency of antidiuretic hormone are also the causes of dehydration. If a person suffered with dehydration, then the volume of extracellular fluid is decreased with a concomitant rise in electrolyte concentration and osmotic pressure. Water is drawn from the intracellular fluid, and that results in shrunken cells and disturbed metabolism, like increased protein breakdown. Antidiuretic hormone secretion is also getting increased. This causes increased water retention in the body, and consequently the volume of urine is also get decreased. Plasma protein and the blood urea concentrations are also get increased. Water depletion is often accompanied by a loss of electrolytes from the body. The principal clinical symptoms of severe dehydration include increased pulse rate, low blood pressure, sunken eyeballs, decreased skin turgor, lethargy, confusion, and coma. Let's see the treatment of dehydration. Intake of plenty of water is the treatment of choice for dehydration. In the subjects who cannot take orally, water should be administered intravenously in an isotonic solution. Usually 5% dextrose solution is preferred. If the dehydration is accompanied by loss of electrolytes, the same should be administered by oral or intravenous route. This has to be done by carefully monitoring the water and electrolyte status of the body. Cholera is a bacterial disease which is transmitted through water and foods, and the bacterium is Vibrio cholerae. This bacterium provides a toxin which stimulates the intestinal cells to secrete various ions into intestinal lumen. These ions collectively raise the osmotic pressure and suck the water into lumen. This results in diarrhea with heavy loss of water, near about 5 to 10 liters per day. If not treated in time, the victim of cholera will die due to dehydration and loss of electrolytes. Thus, cholera and other forms of severe diarrhea are the major killers of young children in many developing countries. The dehydration in the cholera is treated with oral rehydration therapy. In contrast to dehydration, overhydration or water intoxication is caused by excessive retention of water in the body. This may occur due to excessive intake of large volumes of salt-free fluids, renal failure, and overproduction of antidiuretic hormones. Overhydration is observed after major trauma or operation, lung infections, etc. Headache, lethargy, and convulsions are some clinical symptoms, and it is treated with stoppage of water intake and administration of hypertonic solution. In the next part of video, we will discuss about acid-base balance. If you like this video, then do not forget to subscribe to the channel and share this video or a link to your friends or to your students or to your loved ones. Till then, bye-bye. See you in next video on acid-base balance. Bye-bye.